like to call to order the regular meeting at Parabel City Commission. It's Thursday, July 5th, 2018, at 6 p.m. with Parabel City Municipal Complex. I would like to ask Commissioner Allen to please say the invocation, and then we'll say the pledge allegiance to the flag and stand, please.
Our God and Father in heaven, we come to you tonight for thanksgiving for the preservation of those that have been preserved. And we ask your blessings on those that have lost their property and years of accumulation in the fire in this land. We're thankful, Father, for all the wonderful people in this county, in this community, and cities here around that have jumped in to help out for these disenfranchised people. Thankful, Father, to the Father of volunteers in our city that have worked hard to be sure that the distribution of the food and goods and services can be made to the people who have lost everything. We ask you also, Father, to be with our country in this time of need, as we deal with the difficult things that stand before us and the determination of the future of this country in a rather serious and big way. We ask you also to be with us, Father, as responsible to the people of this community, that we may deal judgment righteously, faithfully, and honestly with those things that come before us for the benefit of you, and that we might give you the praise. And we ask all this in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen.
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 I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we've got quite a crowd this evening, and I'm going to ask everyone, it looks like I'm suspecting that some folks are going to want to speak, so I will ask you to please come to the podium and state your name when you're recognized to speak. State your name, and you'll have about 3 minutes to speak. If someone else has already spoken on the topic you would like to speak on, to save time, I would ask you not to repeat. We're going to not have any yelling out from the audience. If we do, I'll warn you once, and then after that, I will ask our chief to escort you out. We're going to act in a civil manner tonight, and we look forward to a good meeting. All right, so we're going to move forward to the consent agenda, which includes our June 7th regular meeting minutes, our attorney's invoices, and this time we have included the four Water and Sewer Department job descriptions that were submitted by the HR committee at the HR workshop on June 28th, 2018. And also what we would like to do, we discussed at the workshop under the consent agenda, we would like to amend the water and sewer superintendent job description and the assistant water and sewer superintendent job description to include wording, quote, must pass background check, unquote, under the duties section.
I'm going to approve.
Okay. So we have a motion by Mr. Allen to approve. Do we have a second?
Okay.
And for discussion, I would like to mention that three motions were left out. A motion under new business on the regular meeting minutes, item four. It originally had votes scheduled for A and B, but it ended up that we took a third vote, and that was in the minutes. And then we also had at the end, Commissioner Millender, motion to adjourn during the regular meeting for the first public hearing to amend the general fund budget, and then Commissioner Millender also motioned to adjourn the first public meeting. So if we could have this motion and second amended to contingency that the minutes reflect those three motions.
I'll second the motion with those amendments.
Okay.
It's got to come from the first.
Yes. Would you amend the motion to your motion to include?
Yes, I'll amend that.
Okay. All right. We have that motion by Commissioner Allen and second by Commissioner Melder. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed? All right, and that motion carries. Okay, we have public comments. Is there any public comment this evening? Okay, Mr. Barry Greer, please come up and state your name.
Barry Greer, I'm a member of the Lanark Village and I'm a member of the board.
Commissioner Greer. Thank you.
Barry Greer, member of the board, Lanark Village. As the chairperson, and I want to read a note from the Lanark Village residents and the LVA board wanted to thank the Carabel Fire Department and Police Department for the quick response to the fire on Heffernan Street. Even though we are not in the city limits, we are always able to rely on Carabel to come to our aid, as they did in 6/29/2018. Coming in support of the St. James Lanark Village Fire Department, potentially catastrophic fire was held to losing 3 units for 3 days, and then smoke damage in the adjoining ones. The Lanark Village residents are indebted to the city of Carabel and being a good neighbor.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate that very much. Is there any other public comment? Any other public comment? Yes. Please state your name.
I'm Pam Curry. I'm here to get a reason that I was denied last month. There was no reason stated, and I was told the subject was closed. And I think I deserve a reason. On August of last year, I was given conceptual approval, meaning I guess my spot was in general okay, the idea was okay, but I was not given any reason that it was denied. And I would like that reason in writing. Anybody here have a reason?
Let me just explain quickly the process. That when we go through a special exception process, it's a discretionary decision by the commission whether or not to grant any special exception. And the reasons for that decision, approval or denial, is basically, talk the lawyer terms here, the part of the record of your presentation, the reasons given by different commissioners for the way that they voted. And I don't want to try to create an additional record after they make their decision, but there is a video of that. So, you know, in watching the video, the concerns and considerations and things that the commissioners stated during their discussion and during your presentation, staff input, anything like that, all combined are the reasons. And I know, I hear what you're saying, and you're saying, hey, I don't know what the specific reason was, but it could be numerous, both for and against the project.
I think I deserve a reason. I know for a fact that the letter that was presented to y'all by Mr. Gashy, every word in it was a lie. I'm sorry, that's the false truth. There's nothing in that letter true. And I can prove it to you. And I can prove it now. Mr. Gashy has been in my yard for 1 year and 8 months. There has been 3 environmental agencies been through my yard and has cleared it. Why we are still listening to the false truth that's being put out or lies? And you can believe Mr. Gashy, you can believe me, but I can go down every one of them and show you they're alive. Now, I don't have any control. I am a child of the Most High God. And if my God says it's not time, I don't have a problem waiting to the time. But he also says, we are under God when we open the prayer. and there's lies circulating, and there's lies that are believed, that if they're said loud enough and long enough, they're held to be true. I do have permission. It has been cleared. All of you have it right there in the city. It's been cleared. Keisha came to my building's property over a year ago and told me to cease anything until it was cleared. Now, a year and 8 months later, those same mistruths, false truths are still coming in here. Now, why you chose to believe I'm the liar? I'm not the liar. I did not stand up here and lie to either one of you. I did not stand up here and tell you I was doing a vacation rental if I'm going to do long-term rental. I did not lie about that. I did not lie about having permission. You can choose to be voted how you voted, but I also need to know, do I have another opportunity? Or do I have to wait a year? I was under the understanding if you're in commercial, you have an opportunity to change your plan.
Ms. McCreary, you cannot bring the same plan forward within a year. If you have a changed plan, you are allowed to bring it forward and ask for a special exception on a, call it a new plan. And if you have new information to accompany that plan, that is
I have the information I can bring out right now.
That's unnecessary. I mean, you do want to save it for the public hearing that's on your issue.
There's nothing.
Okay,
there's nothing in that.
Mr. McCreary, you have had 3 minutes and plus and to.
Well, I have one more
comment.
In my 18 years of owning property in this county, I have never had anybody, city building, county building, disrespect me the way you have.
I haven't done anything.
You ran over me. Everything in came out of my mouth. You told me I was lying about.
I never said that word to you, ma'am.
No, ma'am, you didn't say that, but you said, oh, I believe you're going to have long-term rental. That's the same.
You did. It is possible that can happen. That's what I said. It's possible that it can happen.
But what I said,
if we're not here to argue. You will have your time for public comment. We appreciate it. If you would like a spot on the agenda, would you please request that for the August 2nd meeting?
Well, I feel I have as much due respect as you do. And as a citizen of this county for this long, as a business owner, you don't know me. You've never spoken to me. You've never been in my business. And there's no reason for you to sit there and treat me like I'm a worm.
I'm not treating you like a worm. So I cannot allow you. We've got plenty of people that want to speak tonight. We've got a full agenda, and I'm sorry, but I can't allow you to stand here and filibuster. We need to move forward.
We can certainly move forward, but I've never had anyone disrespect me as an official. Okay. My rest of them have done fine. You were rude.
What was it? Bye-bye. Okay. Now, we have a lot of folks in here. Is there any public comment? This is the only opportunity to have public comment. We won't have another opportunity. We have items that are on the agenda. We will address those items and only those items. Okay, Ms. Pat, please come up. You need to come to the podium.
Hi, my name is Pat Funderburg, resident of Menard Village, and I get the pleasure of working in the fire. Having to see the fire. My only question is who can we talk to about the fact that the hydrants didn't work and the fact that we mustn't have that happen again? I just want to know, who am I supposed to talk to?
That's right, I understand, and I actually asked that question myself.
Thank you.
And it's tragic, it is terribly tragic that the fire hydrant did not work. We had our, that fire hydrant and overseeing all the fire hydrants that are provided water through the water, Fairville Water Service, are overseen by the lead operator of the Fairville Water System. And they're required to keep logbooks on fire hydrants and maintenance, and these logbooks are reviewed annually by the Florida Department of Environmental Protection. And all of our, I had a meeting this morning with our intern water and sewer superintendent, our water and sewer superintendent of 30 plus years, just retired on Friday. And I had a meeting with him, our fire chief, and our chief of police regarding the incident. And all of the hydrant inspections are within the Florida Department of Environmental guidelines at this point. And Mr. Charlie Painter, the interim superintendent, is here to speak to that if he would like to explain to these folks how this hydrant came to not being working. And also, every hydrant is checked in Lanark.
How often, somewhere. Please? How often?
Mr. Charlie.
Okay.
The hydrant in question was repaired today. The other hydrants that I know of out there were not broken. There's only one hydrant out there that was broken. All the rest have been tested today. There's 14 in the village. We went through and tested them all, repaired the one that was there, it was broken. That one, it was broken somehow. It's very hard to break a fire hydrant. That one's been there since 1976. There are all the hydrants out there. I have that. We believe somebody hit it with a car and stood it back up. We didn't know that it was broke. We got a repair kit for it, went back out and repaired it. It did take an extra day because many of the parts were very rusted on the inside of it. It didn't come apart very easily. But it is back together and operational right now.
I have a question. Is
yes.
You guys are in charge of it?
We're required by DEP to keep a fire hydrant log. Test the fire hydrants, but also do flushing, and they kind of coordinate together. When you're flushing a fire hydrant, you're writing down this log, the fire hydrant down, as well as flushing water, and they're all required by DEP to be done. Sir?
What was the last date that one was checked?
So we had a fire there approximately 2 years ago. That was the last time that fire hydrant was used. Now, we have several fire hydrants out there, so they get done in around a percentage a year. We just do Lanark, we do St. James Bay, we do Lanark, and Caravelle, and all the way down the beach. So you call it quite a few fire hydrants. But we work, DEP comes and inspects us, and they inspect those ones.
So, Mr. Painter, if you inspected fire hydrants, say, last week, and then yesterday it was hit or damaged or vandalized somehow, you know you inspected it last week and then you needed it for a fire today and you didn't know that it was damaged yesterday. I mean, is there any way you have, there's no way that you can know unless you check
fire. Unless a resident had seen it or the person that hit it or something that happened to it, that person called us and let us know. They stood it back up and made it look like it was perfectly good operating fire hydrant. I would not know that until we came back through that row.
Okay, please come to the podium and state your name.
Yes,
but we need your name and we need to hear your question. All of us want to hear.
My name is Kat Young. I want to know how often each fire hydrant is checked. When you sit you to a log and check, we're concerned that maybe you're not getting checked and our house is going to catch on fire.
All right. Fire hydrant is a great.
Mr. Charlie, please hold the microphone.
There's probably a 2 or 3 year rotation.
So they're checked every 2 or 3 years?
There's not a specific date set on that when it gets done. They're in a rotation that will be done, and then the percentage gets done every year. I don't have a it'll be done once a year, twice a year, three times a year, I don't have that.
And Mr. Painter's behalf, he just assumed the interim superintendent's job, the water department, who was a lead water department operator, who's also the water sewer superintendent, just retired on Friday. Would that be the person that would have kept the logs on?
Well, we have one here, yeah, we have.
You can have, you can.
Yeah, more than one person does that. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
So, we're.
Ms. Pat, would you please come forward? Use the microphone.
So what you're telling us is that we can get in touch.
Use the microphone.
Settle down and now, you know, have an agenda or whatever. We're going to get in touch with you guys and talk to you about this? Okay.
Sure.
My name's Miranda Marks and I live in Lanark Village and one of my units are burned. And my question is, how long does it take to test the fire, actually, the fire hydrants? 15, 20 minutes an hour? It just seems to me with those units being so old, it doesn't take that long, there's only 14. You know, in a 2-year period or a year period, why couldn't you check them all as a homeowner?
Sure, that's what you say. There are several fire hydrants in there. We should all get that one. Sound like we can step it up a little bit, and we probably can. But we understand fire hydrants designed, it doesn't break. Something physically has to break. You don't, it will always open and put water out unless something's physically damaged.
Okay. With that being said, and you didn't know it was broken, if you do test them all, and you would know possibly if it was broken, if somebody did report it, and you also test the pressure, how much water it puts out. Because a lot of people have complained over the years that when there is a fire, there's not enough pressure. And that's another problem.
So the pressures are maintained by the water towers, and the water towers carries the water in the air and provides the pressure to the system. So if you had two or three fire trucks or fire hydrants open at one time, you would have a slight loss of pressure. That volume of water coming through the pipes just won't carry full pressure, but it doesn't go below. Our requirements would be about 20 pounds by state law.
Okay, please, sir.
My name is James Gidnell. We had the same situation happen about 4 or 5 years ago on Park Street. Well, I was on. Both fire hydrants didn't work in 4 or 5 years ago, and also it took 2 years for me ever get time to do anything. Nobody would tear the buildings down, they shut their burn out forever, it seemed like, and you get nothing done. How long do you think this is going to go for something to be done with this? Or do you have an idea?
Well, that would be the county, and you just said the county, and it took that long for the county to respond, so I would have to refer you to the county commissioner or the county coordinator, because we don't have to.
And also, we had the same problem with the fire hydrants 5 years ago in Parker. They burned out all the 2 units or 3 units on the end that we live in. The same problem we're having now. So I'm just wondering if this is an ongoing problem, is it?
And the same problem as
the fire hydrants coming. I'm not familiar with the same. It's about the same thing again.
Well, we can discuss and review whether or not we need to check these fire hydrants once a year. But as I said, I mean, they can be checked yesterday and damaged today, and we wouldn't know. Please come forward.
Charlie.
Thank you.
My name is Shelly McLean, and it just occurred to me that you said the fire hydrant had been broken by a person. Was it vandalized or was it run over by a truck? And is there an investigation going on? And if not, why? Or will there be? And what happened? Because it will run out, this is not a problem.
So I'm not in the legal business, but I don't believe it's a crime. I don't know why somebody to report it, but there is actually rubber marks on the side of the fire hydrant where somebody's tire actually hit it.
Ms. Nate, do you deserve no investigation going to happen about?
I would have to ask the chief, would there be an investigation on the city side, or would that be on the county side?
I found out there that you can contact the sheriff's office.
So that you would need to contact the sheriff's office. It's, you know, I know it's very complicated, or it's hard to understand. The city of Carabelle sells the landmark citizens of water sewer service. And basically, that's all of the responsibility that we do have, and to maintain the fire hydrants. But as far as an investigation, our police department cannot go out of the city into the county's jurisdiction. That would be the sheriff's department. And, you know, we do the best we can. Our police department and our fire department, our fire chief is here and our police chief is here. We go out there using city tax dollars as mutual aid. The fire district ends at Morality Road, and the Lanark Fire District starts at Morality Road and goes west out to the summer camp Y. And when our chief, both our police department goes over there and our fire department, they go under there, over there and act under the direction of the sheriff's department and under the direction of the Lanark Volunteer Fire Department. That's their district and their jurisdiction. We have one fellow, he was nearest the fire, Chris Granger, who responded, and he was fortunately able to wake up and evacuate all of the residents in the buildings that burned. And I talked with both chiefs today, and I talked with the sheriff yesterday. And if they deem, and it's not under my jurisdiction or any of these people on this board, but if they deem that an area or a home or property is not in harm's way, then they're not going to be awakened or disturbed or brought out to add confusion to trying to handle the emergency or disaster. And all of our fire department firefighters in all of Franklin County are volunteer, and they do that out of the goodness of their heart. And, you know, we're fortunate to have those volunteers come out for no pay. And they train for no pay. And they do the best they can. We're doing the best we can. We don't want to see anyone burned and put out of their home.
No, we know that.
All right, no, and it's not done on purpose, and Mr. Payne doesn't want that, and none of the people in our water department.
Maybe the landmark fire department could work with you so that we can go check them out. Because as the young lady said, the one unit burns, the whole thing, you know.
Yes.
So it's kind of scary.
It is scary.
So maybe we can work out something that we can check more often to make sure that.
And I'll ask all of these residents here to please put the word out in Lanark that the fire hydrants need to have about a 25-foot distance around, sir, one car length,
15 feet,
a radius, clear, so that they can be certainly accessed during an emergency, and so that they can be accessed to maintain. Mr. Painter just showed me a picture of a fire hydrant that he just left that area, and they can't even get to it to maintain it because there's vehicles parked so close around all of the fire hydrants. Of course, our police department doesn't have jurisdictions to write citations, but if people need, you know, access to maintain these fire hydrants and access to get to them to put fires out, then the sheriff's department will have to be contacted, and, you know, I don't know what they do. Do they write citations on that or give warnings? I don't know. But, you know, we all need to work together on this and try to, you know, we want to have good family and good friends with our landlord neighbors. We really do. Are there any other questions? Do the commissioners have anything they would like to say on this topic? You don't have anything you'd like to say on this topic?
I'll have something in my report.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. Anything else? Any other comment on another topic, perhaps? All right, then. forward to the commissioner's reports, and that is Commissioner Allen.
Thank you.
Okay.
While we're on the subject of fires, some of you may have received a letter in the mail stating that the insurance rates will be changed. And I had a talk with Chief Wade about this the other day, and if it would come up, if you give us an explanation, I think you can do it better than I can. Okay, put you on the spot. I should have told you about this before, but I've been thinking about it.
That's okay.
But Carl, right from the mouth.
Carl Wade, Fire Chief here in Carabelle. All the fire departments in Franklin County were recently visited by the ISO, or Insurance Serviceability Organization. And you will see some change. It's really difficult to get your volunteers to attend 208 hours worth of training to become a certified firefighter. It is something we have been pushed into by the ISO. We will have five individuals graduating from Firefighter 1 certification in September. We have one other on our fire department that is Firefighter 1 certified presently. The ISO took our fire rating from a 6 to a 10 because of this lack of training. This is happening all over the country and all over our county. So there is a plan of action being written up now to go back to the ISO, which is required within 60 days. And it's basically what I just told you, to get our fire rating back to a 6 versus the 10 that they've moved us to. The 10 will not take effect for a year. So they're going to leave us on a 6. But if we don't make the corrective action of having the certified firefighters, which we're about a third of the way through the school now, then the fire rating will go to a 10. So a 10 is worse. A 10 is basically like not having a fire department at all.
It's the opposite of normal.
Right, right. Okay.
Thank you very much. Anybody have questions on that?
I do.
Okay.
Chief Whaley, if you will explain, some folks may not know that it affects your rating, but what affects the homeowner is the insurance coverage.
Right. The price of the insurance is set by the ISO rating. So if it's a 10, your insurance premiums are going to go up. That's the reason we're fighting right now to keep them at the 6. We want our ratings as cheap for the homeowners as we can get them. You know, and I don't want you to think we're not trained. We train all the time. It's just they want a professional fire service training for volunteers. And it's a book about this thing. Like I said, 208 hours of your volunteers' time. We've had to back off of the training for the last 2 weeks with the East Point Fire. It has taken up our training area, so we'll be back at it Monday and Tuesday of next week, and we'll be knocking it out.
My name is Richard McClain, and I'm just wondering, do you expect to be able to meet those training requirements within the next year?
Yes, sir. By September, we'll have our people certified.
Okay. And Chief Whaley, all of your personal work as a chief with the state officials, and that is also volunteer. You're not being paid for that, correct?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yes. 208 hours. The city has paid for the training, and we provide the time.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a lot of volunteers in this city that do a lot of work. I wish we could get some more that would be interested big in the fire protection business. And I'd suggest Charlie back there that has to do with the water and the tanks. Maybe you get on the volunteer list, Charlie. You don't have enough to do, do you?
No, he doesn't have enough.
Commissioner, over the last 2 weeks, I have picked up 3 people that want to volunteer. So
that's good news.
We're doing great.
Well, good deal. We're on the roll.
Yes, ma'am.
Can I add one thing?
I know that there are several of y'all from Lenar. They are in desperate need. So I'll ask if y'all, if you know somebody that is willing to do some volunteer, send them toward Mark Dodd, he's your new fire chief, and he really needs the help.
Yes, he does. And so, as you have, Commissioner Allen's not being off the initial.
Yeah, I got something.
Yes.
As the city's liaison with the Emergency Operations Center, and also as one of the CERT-trained persons, we have been mustered to work the recovery efforts for the fire at East Point. And we might be able to help over in Lenar too. Several houses were burned, consumed. A lot of material was destroyed. Boats, dogs, and furniture, as fences. And there's been a humongous effort from the volunteer people around this county, as well as our neighboring counties, all the way to Suwannee County and all the way over to Bay County, and even down south in Central Florida, that have brought truckloads of goods to help replenish the people who lost their furniture and their homes. There's a very strong effort to find replacement places for these people to live. Several have already been found places to live. We have the cafeteria in the back room of our school that's loaded almost to the ceiling with goods that people have brought in to provide. We've got, and I think I'm going to let who's the chairman of the Unmet Needs Committee of Franklin County, who is dealing with the collecting and the passing out of that. So, and I don't want to steal her thunder because she's the guy here. But I just want to thank everybody that's volunteered and been supportive and sent things in to try to replenish and help those poor folks. And the goodwill that has come out of this, I just nearly break out in tears when I think of the good folks in this community that can jump in on occasion like this. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Commissioner Allen. Thank you, and thank you for your volunteer work this past week. I know I've seen you around. All right, then, anything else?
No, ma'am. Happy my state was we got a little bit off the fire department. Anyway, the bottom line is, for me personally, thank the chief to reiterate that, because I was a member of that volunteer fire department for 33 years, Carroll. And anyway, thank you and the volunteers that are attending school. And again, say that you're volunteers, and you dedicate your time, your efforts, and it costs you money because you spend a lot of time in fuel, clothing. You never know if you're in church, in your suit, or what have you. When the call comes, you go. Been there and done that. But anyway, thank you very much for y'all's volunteer time and for all volunteers. Thank you.
All right. Commissioner Mathis, you have a report?
You have no, ma'am. Okay.
Okay, then we have next. Commissioner Walker.
Yep, you said.
Okay, we know I'll have plenty.
I'll get to him.
Okay, and then Commissioner Miller. Okay, all right, here we go. I've got quite a bit here and some action that may need to be taken as well. And now I want to remind you that on Sunday the 24th, there was a huge fire in East Point. And we all know that, destroying approximately 36 homes and consumed about 1,000 acres. And right now, the county officials are working diligently through the recovery and restoration efforts. My husband and I are praying for all the victims and the victims of Lenar and all their families. We understand that everybody that's been impacted in these two fires are eager to get their lives back to normal. But I just want to tell you about the response from the city of Carroll for the East Point fire. Carroll Volunteer Fire Department with two of our fire trucks reported to the East Point fire with seven firefighters, all volunteer. They were present there for almost 12 hours nonstop working the East Point fire. And we're very proud of that. And our Carroll Police Department responded with five officers with their vehicles, and they were out there for most of the night. And I understand the chief even evacuated five horses and one donkey and took them to his own home. to save those animals' lives, because the people had to run. They did not have time to get their animals and their dogs and pets. The Water and Sewer Department contacted the East Point Water and Sewer District and offered manpower assistance if they needed extra manpower and any parts that they might need for emergency, so that they could be helped if they had any fire damage. The City of Carabel immediately accepted donations at City Hall, and the Police Department delivered those immediate donations to the East Point Fire House. Right now, Franklin County Emergency Management is presently using space in this building to warehouse water, food, toiletries, diapers, paper goods, clothing, kitchen and household utensils, household decorative items, linens, mattresses, furniture, household cleaning supplies, children's toys, and meals ready to eat. The cafeteria is jam-packed, stage jam-packed, hallway back here packed, hallway to classrooms. Full. And they still have a couple more days to take donations. And I want to, as everyone else here is, I want to give my sincere thank you to the volunteer fire department, firefighters, and the police officers who were among the first on the scene at the East Point Wildfire. And they were among the first on the scene at the Lanark Fire. And, you know, their quick response to contain these fires helped save lives and property. May not save every bit of property, but they are out there to help, and they get out and give us a home. Thank you to the city staff and our community for their quick response and actions in the aftermath and your outpour. So then I just want to tell the board here, I'm real happy about this. In the June TDC board meeting, I had the opportunity to request and motion for TDC funding of $6,000 towards the rebuilding of playground equipment at the lighthouse known as the Carabel. And my motion was approved, and the funding will be distributed to the city from the county where it must be held in escrow with the insurance reimbursement, so they're able to do it. And then I also want to say that recently I've had requests from nonprofits for rooms, to have a room and space in the new City Hall building, as well as requests to place displays and signage in the new building. And I've explained that the building was designed for efficient, cost-effective, streamlined city operations. And as far as myself, that I can determine at this point, every square foot is accounted for. And I'm asking that folks please let the staff get settled in the new building and see what we have for making commitments to include displays and allowing long-term use by nonprofits in space for rooms. And I would actually request a motion to that effect so that we don't get into something that I'm expecting. Okay, we have a motion to not make any commitments for space or signage or displays at our new City Hall in the near future by Commissioner Mathis. Okay, we have a second by Commissioner Howell. Is there any discussion?
Doesn't include our city complex.
City complex. Oh, no. They've got a sign designed for, and we'll be moving our flagpole over there.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that motion carries. Okay, then I have something else. Last week, the Carabel Police Department had an overnight resignation, plus the loss of one part-time officer, leaving the police department very short of manpower. And it appears officers will be working about 10 days without a day off, resulting in overtime, and they won't be able to pay for the tips and rest that they need to get. An advertisement to hire a new officer has been posted for about 4 days, and the chief is requesting to hire as soon as possible. He spoke with me this morning and has requested not to wait until the next commission meeting for approval. So in this Courtney's report, she's going to be requesting special meeting day to consider hiring the Water and Sewer Department superintendent. So I would ask that we consider this request from the chief under Courtney's report. And then tonight, we have Mr. Mark Melcher here, who I spoke with, he was referred to me that he would be interested in being planning and zoning board member. That's designed for 7 members, and we have 4 members on board, and it requires a quorum of 4. If one is missing, then we can't have our planning and zoning. Mr. Melcher is here. If you'd like to come to the podium and ask if there's any questions and answers. But he has a civil engineering background, has a degree in construction engineering, and worked several different planning departments throughout the Air Force at different military installations. He's a 22-year Air Force veteran, volunteer in Carabel, includes food pantry pickup deliveries, Camp Gordon Johnson Museum, and March on the American Legion Executive Board as well. Okay, and he's an 8-year volunteer firefighter experience in Kansas, and he's a resident of the city of Carabel, and he's would like to serve on the planning and zoning. So, do we have any questions of Mr. Melcher? All right, then. Do you want to make a motion for that?
I do have one comment.
What's his first name?
Mark.
Mark?
Yes, sir.
Chief, if you can call, I'm certified in firefighter 1 and 2 in Kansas.
Well, I'll second the motion.
My congratulations, Paul, North Florida. Can you call?
Yeah. All right, then we have a motion by Commissioner Mathis, a second by Commissioner Allen to appoint Mr. Mark Melcher on the planning and zoning board. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, and that motion carries. Thank you all for bearing with me. That's the end of my report. And we'll move on to the
just staff. One question. Are you related to the Messers here in Carabel?
Melcher.
M-E-L-C-H-E-R.
Not aware of any of here.
I'm asking for you to call special meetings and we can hire the water and sewer superintendent. If anybody's available next week, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, instead of any time.
Okay, and you had mentioned to me the 10th, 9th or 10th?
9th or 10th would be good for me. It's good for you guys.
About Tuesday. About
Monday, Tuesday.
About 1:30.
That's fine.
And would the chief have, you say you had a response to your advertisement, would you like to bring that person forward on when we do this, you can put that on the special meeting agenda for hiring? Okay.
Yeah, I'd like to include that.
Okay. All right, so would you like to, do we want to have a date?
I'm asking you guys, is there a date that's good for you?
Y'all have mentioned the 10th, that's good for me.
The 10th is good for everyone? 10th at 1:30.
All right, so would you like to make that in form of a motion, Commissioner Gallagher?
Yes, Mayor, I will. I'll make a form of a motion to call a special meeting for July the 10th at 1:30 for the purpose of looking at a water and sewer superintendent position and a police officer.
Okay, we have a second. Okay, second. Motion by Commissioner Gallagher, second by Commissioner Walton. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, then that motion carries. Okay, Ms.
All right, also last week, Keisha and I got our first look at the building department software from Franklin County, so we've had a chance to look at it. And Cheyenne came over on Friday and went through it with Keisha. So we're still working with Amy with Franklin County to come up with a date that they want to take over, and we're still working out some kinks, but we're shooting for the 1st of August anyway. I signed a contract for the security system for the new City Hall this past month with Sonatrol, and that will need to do our doors and windows and our inside security monitoring. Richard Fetchek of the ARPC has a $50,000 Economic Development Administration Disaster Recovery Grant Opportunity. The grant funding will be used to develop an economic development element for the county's comp plan, including future land use recommendations, land development regulation recommendations, and workforce training recommendations that enable new commercial development and enhance community character. And the workforce training would align with new business recruitment. The grant requires a 20% match, and so far Mr. Fetchek has received commitments from the TDC for $5,000, Appalachia Cola for $1,000, and Franklin County for $2,000. So they're asking that the city of Carroll would contribute $1,000. So is there any interest in that?
I make a motion we pay $1,000.
Second.
All right, so we have a motion by Commissioner Allen for the contribute $1,000 to this economic development disaster recovery grant. And then a second by Commissioner Mathis. Is there any discussion?
Just a comment. I think this grant's going to support our work that we need to do in our company. Is that correct?
Well, I think it would.
Sorry?
Yeah, it would be a good start for us.
Yes. Be a positive.
We can probably use them all the same way.
Positive, go forward. That's correct.
Now, we've actually referred to their, when we've worked on our comp plan, we can refer to the council. Yes. Is there any other discussion?
No, I'll just say to Courtney, I'm sorry I keep saying, huh, both of these things are going in our ear. We can't hardly hear you, so.
Okay. And that's all I have for tonight.
You all have any? Oh, we need to finish. We have a motion by Commissioner Allen and a second by Commissioner Mathis. And any other discussion? All right, then, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, then that motion carries. All right, do you all have any questions for Ms. Courtney? Okay, then, Ms. Keisha, do you have anything for us? No? Okay, thank you. All right, then we'll move to our, where we have Mr. Russell Barge.
Thank you. Commissioners, I'll be brief with the update evening. Avenue B, construction is ongoing. DEO has approved the contract amendment to include unmet need projects. So we'll be executing that change order for the contractor. On the Keogh's addition project, we do have all the permits now from the Water Management District and Army Corps, so we're ready to advertise for that. So that will happen over the next 2 to 3 weeks. City Hall is progressing on schedule. We're also working on the raw water filter for Wells 3 and 4 and the brine disposal system. Working with Charlie, we do have testing that will be beginning on the spray fill and the termination of the brine and reuse water mix ratio. So that testing is moving forward. On Lighthouse Estates, design is moving forward on that. I would like to make a suggestion that the city consider funding sources for the water system as part of phase one. And there were a couple that Christina from the Water Management District recommended this morning on a conference call, one being the rural development or the other FDP, SRF funding. Now, you understand that there's a loan component to both of those programs, but I do think that would be a viable source of funding for the water system as part of phase one. So just making that suggestion to the commission. And we'll be happy to make some phone calls and set up a meeting if at the commission's pleasure. Okay, and that's our update.
Okay, and I did come in on the tail end of your conference call this morning. I didn't speak or anything, but I listened and I did hear her talk about suggesting to the city to do an SRF loan or something. Just to let the commissioners know, now a loan like that, the rates
would have to support that amount.
That's correct.
Yes.
And you're referring to the water and sewer rates?
Yes, right. The water and sewer rates would have to support that amount. We have three loans on board right now for the water and sewer, or two water treatment plants and our advanced wastewater treatment plant. So something, you know, serious consideration. I mean, we're not in bad debt. But it's difficult for to collect when you just have sewer accounts. It's almost impossible to collect when you have. I really shouldn't say that out loud. So, but you all can talk before me and get a better understanding of it.
I have a question. I think I've asked this before, and if I understand, you're not going to cover east of Beacon Street. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. What about as Beacon Street goes north, all those houses out to the right of that?
Yeah, right. So it may be beneficial to look at a map when we talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a portion that does go to Beacon.
Okay, so those on Beacon Street will get it, but if they're off of Beacon Street, a block or two,
they will not get it.
No, it does go up to the north and turns back around.
To the west.
To the west, yes. So there's a circle out there.
Yeah, but they'll get both
under
sides.
Under phase one.
All right.
Okay. Right. Any other questions for Mr. Large?
Thank you.
Okay, then we'll move on to, if you can just hand this, Ms. Tamara, the microphone, the Caravelle Waterfront Partnership, Ms. Tamara Allen.
Good evening, everybody. I know that you got my report and it's got the grant information in it. The good news is we were able to move forward as of July 1st on the next stage of the grant, and we are going to get the air conditioner for the building at the whole city hall, and the ductwork and insulation in the ceiling, as well as completing most of the requirements for the renovations. So I was really pleased when that worked out. But the only thing I wanted to say is how much I appreciate the support of the commission, as well as the staff in this building and other staff who have been so helpful with us in staging the donation center here in the cafeteria and down the halls and down the halls and down the halls. I have to tell you that last week at the beginning of the week, I was heartbroken. I got sick. Talked to each person who came in and in the fire in East Point, and it was heartbreaking. But starting Wednesday, when people came in with truckload after truckload of stuff, little kids with their little bag of stuffed animals and their little bag of change, it just warmed my heart. And so, in case you room out at all, God is alive and well in Franklin County and in the whole panhandle of Florida as far as finding the best time. Now, we are going to continue to need your patience with us. We know we have a deadline for being out of here. Nobody is more thrilled with that than we are. However, in the meantime, I just have to say that there's been a core group of volunteers, about 10 people, who have worked every day since the fire and have gotten little specialty niches back there. And if you come by and visit, we'll show you. You know, the housewares boxes that everybody's getting and the linen boxes that they're getting and so forth. It's really nice. We are badly needing furniture. We have 27 sofas and we're trying to meet 49 more families' needs. That includes the Lennox people. So if you have tables, chest of drawers, dressers, or any little side tables that we can use, it would be tremendously helpful. We've got the mattresses that have been donated from Bagpipe Furniture for all 227 people. We'll get a new mattress, and we're trying to make them functional. It might not match, but it will be very functional, and a lot of almost all the money will be new. So it's going to get worse back here. Before it's going to get better, because they closed the Church of God, blessing, in East Point who has been the site for taking care of all the people in their immediate needs. They're closing that center tomorrow, and anything that's still there that's donations will come here until we can package it up in bubbles to get it back out again. And we're sending stuff away as fast as anything we don't need, anything that we can share with all the, we came across a lot of things we were referring to as dog towels. And so if people have dogs, they are welcome with some dog towels. Otherwise, we're taking them in large bag of bubbles over to the Humane Society and things like that. So we'll be doing that with clothes and stuff if whatever it would be used. But I want you to know that it's going to keep coming in. It's going to look a lot worse before it's better. But if you'll hang with us just another week or so, I think we got an inventory and we're working on that. So I just wanted to thank you for your willingness to let us be here. I know you're going to talk about the legal part of it later, but I just have to tell you, that's been, I am personally, we did the CERT program because of the waterfront partnership. That was our hazard mitigation piece. So we did that, and so who was it that showed up to man that function at BSC but the Caravelle CERT people? And and I am personally the chairman of the Unmet Needs Committee for the EOC through my role with Frank Hansen Office as the chair here. So, in case you're wondering how this relates to waterfront partnership, I just didn't do it. But you know that. Anyway, thank you all. And if you have some time, I don't mind being hot and sweaty, kind of like here, we've got plenty more work to do. Okay, do you all have questions for Ms. Tamara? Comments?
I have two, excuse me. The, several of the restaurants have provided food for the volunteers. I couldn't name them all.
And people have brought us food. They're taking good care of them. Thank you, Ms. Tamara, and I would
like to mention that I spoke with Mr. Barone and the sheriff yesterday, Mr. Barone, thank you. And the work camp warehouse area, the work camp is available, and they are ready to take items. I mean, like your mattresses, if you're bad cop instead of them bringing them here, they can go there, and the sheriff has offered to move any items or help in any way. He's got inmates that can work for free, and he does it better if they're ready to do laborious work. So, you know, we need to take it instead of, you know, piling everything up here in Caravelle and into a rodent infested building that's slated for decommission, you know, and they're not planning to demo the warehouse at the work camp in the Appalachia area. So it's ready and waiting, I've been told.
Just to reiterate, the volunteer is having volunteers meet here. Thank you very much for your help and relay to all of your volunteers that you have that's been avid every day. It's hot, and I know that they're doing a wonderful job. And thank you very much.
And it's a shame that all the Lanark people are gone. I see them out there having their meeting. That they also don't know that most of those CERT members are from Caravelle. And then, you know, I went back there today, and it's Caravelle people doing the volunteer work, and we tend to carry the load. And I thank you, Ms. Tamara, you're doing a great job. And thank you for your support of your client, Commissioner Allen. All right. Economic Development Council. There's no report tonight. They were scheduled to have a meeting tonight. I spoke with Linda Cowan, who's the acting president. She's under the weather and unable to hold a meeting tonight. And on behalf of the EDC, Linda did prepare three letters of support for the city's three client applications. During our conversation, she mentioned that in addition to being the president, she continues to hold the secretary and real estate representative positions. And she has requested that in light of need or desperate need for additional EDC board members, which are volunteers as well, and Linda's a volunteer, she's requested that the EDC go to biannual board meetings until additional members can be recruited to help provide the diversity of input for economic development in Carabel and to help carry the load. So I don't, do we need a motion for that to move to, I know we went to quarterly, the motion done. Do we need to do that to move to biannual at this point?
I think that would be up to them. They're on the little.
Okay.
All right.
If we find we need a motion, we can do it at the next meeting. Okay? All right. Then we'll move on to the Carabel Aviation Advisory Board report.
Good evening, everybody.
There you go.
There we go. Good evening. Tonight we'll have on the agenda a resolution for JSA to fund to fund the engineering inspection for perimeter fence. When that JPA was written, they didn't include the cost of engineering and inspections as the project goes along. We had some money left over from the JPA that we were using for tree removal. That job's just about complete, and we've got enough to cover this for the resolution. Any questions?
Any questions on Mr. Sullivan's report? Okay. I have one item to report under the airport report is that I've been recently in communications with Mr. Andy Key, and he's the Aviation Development Administrator at the FDOT Aviation and Space Force Office. And Mr. Keith and his staff are preparing a workshop to be conducted in mid-September here in Carabel. And if it's hot, I'll locate another place, maybe the Senior Center Library. And their presentation will include discussion of FAA and FDOT regulations and guidelines regarding operations and management of general aviation airports like our Carabel Airport. For me and Mr. Sullivan and Ms. Cindy and myself attended the FDOT workshop regarding the new airport zoning regulations, and we all realized how helpful that one-on-one workshop was. And workshop that they're going to address here, the guidelines on small general aviation airports, is going to be very helpful to city staff, elected officials, the Aviation Advisory Board, and the public. And they're going to plan for an opportunity for question and answer from all of us and the public. It's going to be more educational and informative than our tour of the, Mr. Painter, the wastewater sewer plant and the water treatment plant. I mean, they're going to really help us understand the guidelines and requirements. And I believe it's important for city staff and elected officials to be as informed as possible, because these are items in which we're making important decisions, and we need to have a good understanding before we make these decisions. So as soon as I have a firm date, I will let Courtney know, and so that we can circulate and make our schedules, because we'll have to schedule around them. They're very busy. This is the Florida Department of Transportation Aviation and Space Force Office, and they oversee Miami-Dade Airport, you know, big places. So we're very fortunate to have them come here to Carabel. And they, Mr. Keith has asked that Mr. Sullivan and I meet with him next Thursday at their office in Tallahassee, where he can kind of review his presentation and get some help on it.
So this should help too with the master plan coming up. Kevin Lund will probably make a presentation to you either August, September, depending on how far along they've come up with their covenant. So this will, they're kind of complement each other.
And if we can know, if they let us know in advance, we'll let some other airport operators and other elected officials in the area know, and they'll attend, and maybe through the ARPC. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the next advisory board report is the Carabel Human Resources Committee, Mr. Tom Magnin.
Yes, I do. Good evening, everybody. The Carabel Human Resource Committee met twice in the month of June, on the 13th and the 27th. The overall goal for those two meetings was to finish the final four job descriptions for the Water and Sewer Department. and get them into that final draft form, which was presented to the commissioners, and were approved tonight. So we achieved our goal for the month of June. That means that all the job descriptions for the water and sewer department are now complete and have been approved. And I think myself and the other members of the committee are really, I'm really happy that that was accomplished. And we're going to move on now. And also, on the we also had a workshop with the commissioners to go over those final draft job descriptions, that final draft format on the 28th of June. So we're going to move now into July. We have meetings scheduled for the 11th and the, let's say, 25th. And we are going to start working on the police department job descriptions. And our goal for July is to have those job descriptions in that final draft format by the end of our second meeting, or at least by the next meeting, then we'll meet with the commissioners the next time, which I would believe to be a workshop or a special meeting, and that's where you would decide which format you want to have. So, and I guess the only other comment I have is that I really give the committee members a lot of credit for working very diligently on these job descriptions and getting them done in a timely fashion. So, and I believe you should have my report that I submitted, yes, that you can see the synopsis of each of those meetings that I just talked about. So,
you all have questions or comments?
Just a comment. Another volunteer. Thanks, John.
Mr. Sullivan before that, and then Mr. Bryan is there as well, volunteers. I do want to, during our workshop that where we reviewed the four descriptions that we just approved, we discussed whether or not we wanted our next meeting on July 26th to review their next job descriptions. Do we want that to be a workshop or a special meeting? We need to just decide that quickly here now. That's going to be on July 26th at 1:30. So that's already scheduled. How do we want to tackle that? We all prefer to continue with workshops and approve them under the, or disapprove under the consent agenda, or would you like to have them at a special meeting and approve right there? Would you like to call it a special meeting?
Okay.
He says that his administrator, he won't be here that day. But now, one thing you could do, they'll have them ready to review, preview and send your comments to Ms. Horton in advance.
Those job descriptions will probably be completed. I think the day of that meeting, if that's correct, or I think that our last meeting is the day before that. The date that we picked up.
That's correct. It's on the 25th and the 26th.
I would think that the meeting is at 1:30, so we probably won't, they probably won't be ready in advance.
Will you have a draft that Commissioner Allen might be able to review before?
I think so. I think that could be arranged, yeah. It may not be in an absolute final format, but we certainly could be close to it.
We may have some punctuation or grammar, but for the most part, it should.
Okay, all right.
You should have a good draft there for that first meeting. Which is, and was that
the 11th?
The 11th. Mm-hmm. You should have a good draft there.
Okay.
Because I know Chief Putting has already done a lot of work on his job description, but it's just a matter of discussing that.
All right, so then would you like to make that in the form of a motion for a special meeting? So Commissioner Walden would like to have that in the form of a special meeting on July 26th at 1:30. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
And that was Commissioner Mathis. second. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And then that motion carries. And thank you, Mr. Magnin. We appreciate it. All right, then, we're going to move under new business and city election, discussion of possible action concerning election, city election matters. And I'll just give a heads up, I'm going to call for a little recess after this item. I've had several public individuals from the public request that the city elections be held simultaneously with the county and federal elections the first Tuesday in November on even years. And earlier this year, I spoke to Ms. Heather Riley and spoke with her, you know, to review this. It's not called for in our charter. Of course, anything that we would, any changes like this would certainly require an amendment to the charter. Ms. Heather was invited to attend tonight and had planned to, and she had my questions in advance to work out and look up Florida statute, but she had a family emergency and she's at TMH right now. Excuse me, but she reported, and we had city elections coinciding with county elections, it would result in a substantial savings to the city. The city would use the same polling location as the county, so there would be no cost to the city for polling. Poll workers training would not be required for paying of poll workers training because the county would already be paying for that. No cost for ballot printing. The county would pay for the printing cost. The only cost to the city would be for coding, which is for classification analysis and results and statistical data. And the term limits must be considered. Certainly would require an amendment to the city charter. It would alleviate the number of duties for the clerk during a very busy time of the year. As she's recently explained, that's when clerical mistakes can be made. We would no longer have the newly elected officials participating in the final vote on the next fiscal year's budget. I understand that Sock Choppy recently amended their charter and moved their city elections to coincide with general elections, the county's general elections. So they did that in 12 or 14. I talked to Ms. Schilling about it. So then I called the Florida Division of Elections, and I called the, which they couldn't help much on my questions. And then I called the Florida League of Cities, and I had Courtney or Keisha, one of them circulated this survey that they did last year regarding how many cities hold municipal elections in the November general elections, how many do not hold primary elections, which we would, 55% do not require runoffs, which we would, 91% of cities contract with the local supervisor of elections to run their municipal elections. And that was one of my main questions to Ms. Riley. If we contracted with the supervisor, the county supervisor of elections, if the city contracted, would there be a money savings as well? Or would the, if the city still manage its own elections, but just held them on the first Tuesday in November, on even years? I took her our printout from Ms. Miranda of what our elections cost last year, and Ms. Heather estimated it would save about $5,000 if we did that. So I've talked with Mr. Harkin briefly. I had really prepared for Ms. Heather to give a presentation tonight and answer all of your questions. So we'll most likely, she said she would get on the second meeting, and we'll most likely have to, unless you all want to have further discussion. I know Mr. Lynn Holcomb might like to have a comment on this as well. And then there's another item, like the same main item that I want to have Mr. Hartman explain here just a moment.
My name is Cliff Holcomb. I moved here in the year 2003. My first city election was in 2004. We spent a whole day campaigning and everything.
We can't hear you. Can you put the mic a little closer?
Hold it closer to your mouth.
Is it on?
Yeah.
Is it on?
Yes.
All right. 2004 election was my first election here, that I voted here, and we only had two people on the ballot. And I thought, what a waste of time and money. The city failed. For all the time, all the people, all the paperwork, two people did a vote, election. Background coming through, I almost said arrested.
Arrested.
And over the years, I've broached the same subject to different commissioners, the people running for the commission. They always say, well, we just gotta have a change in charge. That'd be too difficult. One year, I came back from voting, and I saw a friend, a neighbor, and I was going to go and vote. It's too much trouble. And I said, well, do you have the same attitude? You feel the same about county and state and federal elections? Oh, no, they're important. You know what she was saying? You guys aren't important.
We knew that already.
Well, I think you're important.
Thank you.
And I think the people who came out to vote thought you were important. The thing is, if we do move to the even year or the odd years of the county and the state and federal, we're going to get more people coming out to vote. Some of you may not like that, but there will be more people coming to vote, and those people who think those are important will get a ballot to work on you guys. That's why I think it's important, because it doesn't matter who you vote for, as long as you vote. That's a basic tenet of freedom. And I looked at the survey from the League of Cities, and to me it looks like a 50-50 deal. There's no overwhelming support, there's no overwhelming non-support. But just because other people do something or other people don't do something is not the reason for us to consider. We need to consider what is best for the city, for the people who care about it. I thank you.
Thank you, sir. And Ms. Heather did comment that if the city of Carabel took that step, which you could expect that the city of Apalachicola might very well do the same as the United States. So, and there would certainly be a greater turnout and want people to vote. So the next item that was requested by the public, which turned out to be some interesting history, and Mr. Martin's going to explain on that, was to, they wanted the commissioners to run by seat rather than at large as we run now. And the commissioners had run by seat in many years past, so we'll turn to Mr. Martin for, and I do have some of your paperwork here that I can share as well.
Just a quick background. In 2005, when I was newly hired as city attorney, Frank, I remember the day. This was an issue. The city had been running elections for seats, not at large, for a number of decades prior to that, and it became an issue raised by some of the citizens. And it turned out that the charter is pretty clear that it's an at-large election that is not proper to run for seats. In particular, not the way we were doing it at that time. So we, at some serious expense and turmoil, in the summer of 2005, both these issues were addressed as far as when the elections were held, what seats were up each 2 years. They were off track at that point also due to some resignations. Had been off track for a number of years. So we got everything back on track in 2005. And also got things back to following the charter as far as commissioners being elected at large. So, just as the mayor said, what is being described as far as changing the time period of when people are elected, when we conduct elections, the terms of commissioners, or running for seats or at large, would require, it's a wholesale revision to Article 2 of the charter. So that needs to be considered, certainly something can be done, but we did go through this in great detail 15 years ago. So we could certainly revisit it, but it's, to the commission to do so. But we have not historically, for its worth, kind of feel this way on vacating right away and things like this. I cannot think of an amendment to the charter that we made. I mean, it's like amending your constitution. I mean, you may disagree with the provisions of the charter, and then you go through the amendment process within the charter, but it is a it's a process seldom used.
Now, these two memo to the clerk back in 2005, and then the letter that you have, and both of them are very nice, well written. That you wrote to Ms. Matthews with the Division of Elections actually pertain to the running of seats, really, and not changing the election date. And the running of seats where the commissioners for several years, a few decades, were running for seats and not as districts, but just I'll run for the Water Sewer Department, Commissioner Matthews will run for streets and roads and so forth. That could be done. It wasn't called for by the charter. The charter called to run at large, as you explained to me. And then we can't, Carabel, as you explained to me, Carabel cannot run for seats unless we are assigned or designated by the state because of demographics. Is that correct?
Well, demographics, but you would actually have to draw districts. So you have certain population within the city divided into, really in this case, four sections. The city would be divided into four sections. That division could be subject to legal challenge and everything else, but it just would be kind of rare that cities our size would go to that extent.
But I understand that we can't, the city cannot do that unless the state designates.
Sorry, the demographic issue is one, for instance, that the county faced that we talked about, and that issue is civil rights issue. So there can be federal mandates based on demographics and based on racial makeup that can be put down, and that is runs in parallel to the break it up into geographic.
And the counties have problems with the districts anyway, but they want the county to take that. They really pass the laws county wide.
Commissioner, would you use your microphone, please?
Commissioner Milner brought me up to speed on that. Is subsequent, and it's irrelevant to the city of Carabel. It's just that was how the county had that imposed upon them by the federal government, later voted to go back to at large, but they were really unable to at that time because they're still under federal preemption.
Do you have comment at this moment? Comment from the commission?
I think our system is very fine and very easy. If we can get appointed at large, then the mayor then makes the choice of who's best fitted for each department. If we ran for seats, the person running for fire would have to argue that he had fire experience running the fire department. As it is, we just make she makes the choice and it works out very well. I don't really see for our little town that it's really worth going through that kind of change, getting a charter change. I think we have a refined system to work for them.
As far as me, I kind of echo what Commissioner Allen just said. As far as it pertaining to running at large versus running in districts or for a specific seat. Again, as attorney just explained, he gave me some education on the background that happened many years ago. I remember those days of the elections in the city of Carabel, and so do you and others, Frank, particularly, that you ran for a particular seat, whether it be fire commissioner, whether it be police commissioner, whatever, and then you just explained that. But as Commissioner Allen said, I'm content with it. As far as I'm concerned, I think it's
when I say intent, it's not a personal preference, it's a business preference. I feel like that we're good there. The only thing that I see that we could consider, if the board wants to consider, is the timing of it. And when we wanted to hold the election, versus when we now hold the election, and look at the pros and cons of making a modification there if necessary. That's just my opinion.
I feel the same way. You know, with seats, I mean, that would be very complicated to try to do that at this point. And as Mr. Hartman says, you run into some legal issues if you don't decide if the districts are spot. But as far as changing the dates to coincide with the general county elections, that's something that we can consider. I would suggest a table on this item and let Ms. Heather come and speak to us and tell us exactly what services would be provided and what kind of funding she thinks that the city would save and what does it entail with an amendment to the charter, Mr. Hartman.
Mayor, I make a motion to be tabled the item to the next convening.
All right. And then do you want to ask let Mr. Hartman answer that question now, or would you like for him to study that
before
our next meeting?
Sure, but
okay. So we have a motion to table this item to the next meeting, but and then do we have a second? Okay. Motion to table and a second, and we'll have discussion with Mr. Hartman to let us know what the details for a charter amendment. The motion is by Mr. Millinger, and the second by Commissioner Allen.
Let me give you my preliminary
answer,
and then I'll certainly get back if I'm wrong. It has to be done by ordinance, and it requires a super majority, 4 out of 5.
Thank you.
Reserve the right to adjust that a little bit. That's my recollection. I got it right here.
That's what I read today. You're the attorney.
All right. Is there any other discussion on this item? Okay. All in favor of tabling until August 2nd?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. And then that motion carries. That will give you all a little bit of time to do some research and about your decision. All right, then let's take a 5 minutes or so. You said. Okay, Commissioner Mathis.
I gotta have more room than that.
You left all alone in here.
Did not have a monthly fee because we're under so many employees.
So that's what we look into. They do all kinds of reports and time tracking and everything we want to see.
These software, they put Wi-Fi time clocks and they interface with the cloud. They have an account in the cloud, and then the administrator, which would be the HR administrator, which could be any of the staff, Courtney, Miranda, Keisha, can access the account every day.
I think you could probably set up where a department head could review their own department.
Yes.
Not everybody else's, but they could go in and keep up with their department's time or who's here and who's not.
On a daily basis and hourly basis, and you can see, you know, they come in and Ms. Courtney wants to see who's checked in every department. She can log in there and see if everyone's checked in or not. The grant that we have looked at would allow for a fingerprint or a PIN code. They need three time clocks, one for City Hall, one for Streets and Roads, and internet would have to be installed there, but it would be a good thing. These things would be bolted to the wall. They wouldn't be going home or driving around in cars with employees or anything like that. Then only one at the wastewater treatment plant is all that's needed, because the DEP has designated that as the headquarters for the water and sewer department. So we really don't need a time clock at the water department in Carabel like we've had in the past. So I think it would be a good thing. I think it would be a step up, and it would allow the Miranda to access times instead of waiting for clocks to be brought in or time cards to be brought in and trying to read time cards. And the property can be set up where it would alert Courtney or the manager at the time that someone didn't check in, which was key to their schedule.
Make a motion to approve the time clock.
Okay, we have a motion. All right, so we have a motion by Commissioner Mathis to look forward on these Wi-Fi capable time clocks, and second by Commissioner Walton. Any other discussion?
Yes, ma'am. A couple of questions. Courtney and I talked about part of it. The time clocks, can your department heads access? Are they going to be able to access their employees' performance on the time clocks at their will, just like your HR person would be able to?
Well, I believe from what I've read, you have to set it up and give them access to certain things. They wouldn't have access to everything. But they can pull it up and view it. I wouldn't want them to have access to change anything.
Okay. Well, our system, IRB, back to my profession, supervisor actually had to sign off on the employee's time. They had to authorize it. Most supervisors authorize an employee's work assignments every day, and they actually set their work assignments, and they authorize what they do and their time that they do it, authorize their time off, their vacation, sick leave, etc. But anyway, the employee was responsible for completing their own time sheet similar to what you're looking at. But the supervisor also had to authorize that it was correct. Factual, it was accurate, it was correct. And I've had conversations, well, there's always conversations. The best manager of the time is your department head. If that department head is following and watching and doing their job, then they should be following the employees. But anyway, it sounds good. I'm in favor of it, but there's other parts of it, I think, that should be inclusive to make it more effective. Just a question I had. But yes, I'm in favor of the time clock, especially being mounted to where it's going to stay at that particular location.
There's all sorts of things it does. I would assume that we would be able to do that, but we could check into it and make sure before we purchase.
What kind of cost would you be looking at, roughly?
The time box that we looked at, it has no monthly service fee, The clocks were about $160. I think they had one down some too. I don't think that was the cheapest one. They have $129.
It's not bad. I mean, I...
Purchase, yeah.
You're purchasing three of them, and there's no monthly fee with that particular brand.
Would you be able to pull it up on your computer?
Yeah.
They're there today, or they're not there today, or they on leave, what time of leave they on?
Any time of the day, sure.
That's part of what I'm talking about. If you authorize that.
Yeah.
And it might, his job where he didn't work, he just supervised.
Yeah, he had work, and I think that's how the rent is, have to oversee the time.
It'd make it a lot easier on the rent.
Yes, it would.
Yes.
And I believe it can be instituted for only three time clocks of $1,000, or, I don't know.
This money well spent.
And how old are the time clocks that we're using now?
Yeah, probably about 10 years.
But they're important.
They're important.
All right, so is there any further discussion?
Nope.
Nope.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion carries. All right, any discussion? All right, item three, discussion of possible action on memorandum of agreement with Franklin County, says EMS, but it should be Franklin County Emergency Management Operations Center, as to use of city property. And Mr. Millender, Commissioner Millender and I attended the county meeting on Friday where they declared a state of emergency. And I'm just going to give you a brief briefing here, very brief on what they discussed. It won't be everything. All of it doesn't pertain to us and the housing here, of warehousing inventory. But the county is focusing on providing temporary housing to FEMA park models. I talked to Michael Verone later that day on the phone. He's expecting the first units within the next 2 weeks. And he expects to have most all the units that are needed, that are required to get families in some type of undercover home type situation within the next 60-day time frame. The county commission passed an ordinance to allow these FEMA units for up to 2 years because they say permanent housing is $1 million away. Permanent housing will run around $80,000 each because they're going to require mobile homes that are built to zone 3 or stick-built homes that are built to code. So they're going to allow these FEMA units in that area for up to 2 years. So that's really long-term temporary to me anyway. And they're working on a CDBG grant to help purchase some housing, and the Sheriff's Department has dedicated all of their collections to purchasing housing, full-time housing, regular homes. So the items, and Ms. Tamara has reported that they're already shipping out items, but the items that are being warehoused here at City Hall, really according to that report, should start being distributed to the recipients of the FEMA units within a couple of weeks, as soon as they start arriving. Mr. Marone told me these FEMA units will not have furniture, so the families are definitely going to need the furniture and the beds that Ms. Tamara's talked about, and certainly household items. But all of the folks in the county know we're here to help, and we're anxious to help with the recovery. And they know also that these items have been brought to a rodent-infested building. And it's slated for decommission and demolition. So, it's not too long, the time frame needs to be designated. So I feel, we have agreements. In fact, tomorrow I'm signing a memorandum of agreement regarding the agreement that we have with the county for our permitting procedures that we're going to take on. So it's important to have this agreement. This includes all the specifics, and the county attorney and the county coordinator are aware, and they agreed to it. And I know you all have been circulated on an agreement, and we need to get some.
place since several.
I can motion to do this.
Okay, that's very good. So we have a, and have you had an opportunity to review and also Mr. Taylor has sent a letter. So we have a motion by Commissioner Allen to take the memorandum of agreement, second by Commissioner Mathis. Okay, is there discussion?
So we need an interlocal agreement.
It can't hurt to do a memorandum of agreement with County ES.
That's what we're talking about.
And we're not, I mean, what I think Mr. Allen's talking about too is I don't think we want to, well, it'd be up to the commission whether we want to actually get a formal interlocal agreement, a whole bunch of requirements that are associated with that. We just want to enter into a memorandum of agreement that's quite sufficient for this. It's not as much rigmarole that we have with an interlocal.
Any comment on that? I would say I don't think an interlocal agreement is necessary at this time since it's a temporary situation. That's my comment. And also, I would like to ask that all of the, and actually it's in the agreement, that all of the dog pet food and any food items like crackers and cereal, rice and pasta, and I talked to Mr. Marone about that yesterday because we have rodents pretty good here, and he said that the county animal control, humane society, that they can take that dog food like right now. And we're getting, brought a fellow in 50 pounds today because it smells so strong and good, and we just we don't need to add fuel to the fire. And I beg your pardon?
I've been talking to them.
Okay, and then also the food pantries in the target zone, affected zone, can take the boxes of crackers and cereals that they can get into the picnic for them to take those. So do we have any other comments?
And what is the motion?
Oh, the motion, Commissioner Allen, motion to accept this memorandum of agreement and send it on over to the county. Commissioner Mathis, second floor.
We just need to have some clear direction on what we're doing. This is a wonderful thing to support people in need, but we have to have some kind of orderly direction on what we're doing. That's what we need to do.
Okay. Is there any other discussion? All right, then. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, then that motion carries. All right. I would like to ask for a motion that going forward, request for occupancy or use of city property longer than a 24-hour period should be approved by the city commission. It's a dire, crazy emergency. The mayor should be notified of the request in a special meeting as soon as possible. If there's some kind of emergency, the city property needs to be used longer than a 24-hour period.
I'll make a motion to that effect.
Okay. So we have a motion going forward. All occupancies and uses of city property longer than a 24-hour period must be approved by the commission. Okay. And that motion is by Commissioner Millender and second by Commissioner Walton. Is there any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, and that motion carries. All right. Number four, item four, discussion and possible action regarding special exception at 111 Northwest Avenue C. Yes.
Am I just skipping?
I'm skipping. Tell me number three.
The security system, Lawrence Sutton, New City Hall.
The agenda was amended since that. Keisha sent out an amended agenda on Monday. next item would be item four, discussion and possible action regarding special exception at 111 Northwest Avenue C.
Do you have a question for this one? I'm not really looking at this address.
But this one is, this one was one that came, it came up in an application about a year, over a year ago. The letters were sent out, came back, no objection. We did also approve, I believe, the home next door, adjacent to it for a special exception. And this is a special exception for residential use in a commercially zoned area. It's not similar to this query that came up earlier. This is the residential use in commercial zoned area. I think it was just the one where it was a mobile home before, got torn down, they brought a new one in. So it was a mobile home before that was in use, it was older and lacked it, they tore it down and brought a newer one in.
I have a motion to approve.
A second.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Mathis. Second by Commissioner Allen. Discussion?
Yes. From this standpoint, from a business standpoint, I think it would be probably common practice to make a special exception. But I have an issue with doing something after the fact. I'm not clear on the process.
All right, let me explain the background on this one. This is why this one's called different than others that we've had, is these folks applied over a year ago, along with another property at the same time, and they were both up for review at a P&Z meeting. That P&Z meeting is a number of them. Now we've got a new gentleman on the P&Z board that may help us film. Did not have a quorum, so it was not approved at that time. And then the typical process was it would move on to the city commission and be approved or not approved at the city commission. There was two of them. One of them went ahead. This one basically fell through the cracks. And what has happened in the background on it is the clerk put together about a 29-page background on just how it fell through the cracks as far as it not making it to the city commission a year ago. And the people who applied basically assumed that they had received a special exception approval, and when you call that the facts, you're right, they moved from a home on this lot. So this is that. It is that property. Normally, in the normal course, that is not how it goes. People don't come to us after the fact. They're coming to us before they put the mobile home on. But if you had a chance to review the package the clerk put together, the clerk was asked to do that because of exactly what you're talking about.
Well, I have. I've reviewed it. And like I said, I mean, I'm in favor of granting the special exception for the property owner. But the process for a year, it failed through the cracks.
Yes.
I've made my comments, and they're aware. And I've actually got, I asked the staff, has the property owner been made aware of the situation? I haven't received an answer on that yet. And then I have also asked the staff to explain why the land use zoning permit for development boards, as we call was sent to the EPCI in addition to permits. It looked one way, it had certain entries on it, and then the one that was presented to us in the packet had certain entries on it. So, you know, I've asked for that, but I mean, it's a done deal. People have their mobile home there, they've got their boat there, clothes are hanging on the line in the back, and, you know, they're making themselves at home, and so.
And I'm going to vote in favor of the special exception, but I do have issues with the longevity and the falling between the cracks for a period of time, to me, that's unacceptable. Everyone makes an error, and everyone, you know, you look over something or you forget something, but not for that length of time.
Well, the mobile home was just placed there. That's the reason it was problem. The mobile home was just recently placed there. That's why it was a problem.
But the process took place almost a year ago?
I've been dealing with these people for 2 years.
And I
made them very aware that they had to get a special exception. I was very aware that it was my mistake. Everybody makes mistakes. I've never, ever made a mistake like that.
Let's move on.
Okay. All right, I do need to mention, I've had public comments and just so that the commissioners know, Mr. Sean Kinder and Steve Frank and Jill Reese are all property owners, and they say that they're sorry that they could not attend the meeting, but they say their comments, this is public comment, or it needs to be known. If the city of Caravelle plans to improve, enhance, grow, and attract residents, industry, and tourists, we have to start improving the quality of our improvements. They see no problem with allowing the lot to be used as residential, but we should in no way be allowing the introduction of new mobile homes within the commercial district of Caravelle. It is a hazard in the case of a hurricane, and it is not improving the attractiveness of our city. We need to be removing these mobile homes rather than allowing more to be added, at least within the commercial zone of the city, if not the entire city. We need to be moving towards more permanent, attractive structures to improve the curb appeal of Caravelle in order to improve the economic base, which taxes are derived. And they do not think adding a mobile home in this location is a step in the right direction, but I did advise them that the mobile home was already in place. It was allowed in place without the opportunity for input from the PNC or the commission or their public input. And so we're here now to go ahead, as Commissioner Mann said, to go ahead and call for a vote.
I understand there was a mobile home there, and then there was another replaced.
The property changed hands. It sold, and then another person purchased the property, and so they had to come to a special exception.
All the damn people came before the house, they got to go with the mobile home.
And that's just a comment from Mr. From three folks, three public.
I understand what Commissioner Miller is saying, and unfortunately, things didn't go smoothly, but it is what it is, and it ain't what it ain't, and it's there, and it's done, and we screwed up, or we didn't do right, or we should have done this, we should have done that. But let's get this thing taken care of and move on with other things.
Okay, I'm
going to
call for a vote.
Okay.
All right, so all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, then that motion carries, and that was unanimous?
Yes.
Okay, that was unanimous.
Well, again, I'm going to say this. I was not opposed to the variance.
Okay, then. All right, we're going to move to old business. Item one, discussion of possible action regarding awarding bid for weekend holiday park janitorial maintenance services. So, Ms. Courtney, what did you receive?
I received one proposal from Captain David's Lawn Maintenance, Inc. for $300 a week.
Say what now?
$300 a week.
Okay.
That's 2 months.
Is that wrong?
And I feel like with only one bid, we have to, you know, we need to postpone this and have it re-advertise. I understand there was another application that got into play.
Let me throw this out for the commission to decide, obviously, how to handle it, is because we did go through an advertisement bid process. We would have to, if we stick within that process, and you would reject all bids, just basically saying, hey, we're not accepting any of them, and then say, okay, authorize us to put it back out for bid, table bids.
Can
okay? And so that's the one process. The other process, the other process is, because what we're talking about is likely hundreds of dollars a month, as far as the total cost of this, does let the administrator, and we've gone through a number of people on this. I know just when I've been up here, maybe three or four, okay? And we're literally spending money advertising, going through this process, everything else. City administrator, certainly within her monetary amounts and everything else, to just try and, you know, have an amount that we say, hey, we don't want to spend more than X per day for cleaning, and then just let her fill it on a rotation as needed, basically. I mean, obviously, hire somebody to do it. You can do a contract with them, but it's a tough job, and people just kind of fade in and out, and understand it. But that way, it's not constantly, you know, we're spending just advertising, and we're spending
yes.
a month or two worth of salary just there.
I will say it's a administrative. I mean, when we hire part-time for the police department, we don't come to the commission on that. So, I mean, this is a part-time job. I would suggest, though, part of the job included, we added cleaning the river's edge once a month, and I would suggest maybe asking Mr. Myrick when his next bid comes up, or if you could add that, or you could put this on the CRA agenda coming up, and maybe add that portion of his work cleaning that river's edge once a month, but then just go ahead and advertise for Westman when you might want to have them.
I kind of agree with time, not too much time in the city meeting, spending all this money out of time. It's a pretty dirty job. So people get in it, they find out it ain't what they're saying it is. So I just think we need to set a salary on that herd in the best legal body. Of course, we got to do a rejected idea.
Yeah, I would say two things then. One, a vote to reject all bids, if that's what y'all want to do, and then a second vote. Setting a giving Courtney authority to hire it and not to exceed maybe a per day amount so she can negotiate it under that and set her handle.
Okay. Do we have a motion to reject all bids?
I'm making a motion to reject all bids.
Okay, we have that motion by Commissioner Wall, second by Commissioner Allen. Any further discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed? And that motion carries. All right, so now we want to, since we're in agreement to give Ms. Courtney the authority to hire, but with a certain amount per day.
I think we should set the amount, because
I don't know.
Well, I can tell you this. The last guy done it for $70, he lasted 2 months, $70 for 2 days. Got the court that done it for $100 today. I think that's more fair than the $70. Now, if it's a holiday like yesterday, we can get paid for an extra day because the road and street department's off on those days. And yesterday, I went down there and cleaned that thing. Now, all three trucks in the dark.
People worked all day.
And I think that $100 would be 2 days that they work.
And not to exceed $200 a week.
Well, now, during Thanksgiving holiday, you got four holidays, but you got Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So, yeah, that'd be the only week. Now that there's 4 days in here.
So, just $50 a day, not to exceed $50.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion for that.
Okay, so we have a motion by Commissioner Mellinger to give Courtney the authority to hire janitorial services and not to exceed $50 per day. By Mr. Mellinger. Do we have a second? Okay, well, we have a second by Commissioner Walden. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion carries. Number three, discussion and possible action. up, speak to us.
If you'd like, sure.
Microphone and tell us why Mr. Finch wasn't being able to speak to us. And we did receive his application, commercial lease application, and he needs to also receive a regular commercial lease so we can review that. He told me the application was requesting a 3-year term.
My name is Kip Kane. Kip Kane, and I addressed you last month on behalf of the Little Custom Homes entity that wants to participate with Carabelle in making this beautiful place. Mr. Denton has 4th of July, and I'm not going to give him any excuses why he's not here, but it was the 4th of July that caught he in traveling plans and previous engagements. Now, I am an associate of the Little Custom Homes, and I explained before, I'm also a commercial broker licensed in the state of Florida. So I'm here to bring Little Custom Homes to manufacture homes, affordable homes, in Carabelle, in Franklin County. That's the objective. When you met the gentleman the other last month, they were a little optimistic about being here almost in 3 weeks. However, their target date now is August the 1st. Now, during that time, yes, they would like a long-term lease, but I'm prepared to negotiate with the three members that were appointed at the last meeting, which was the mayor, Courtney, and the attorney. And I could sign, and they had emailed to Courtney, or they should receive the email tonight, that I am authorized to negotiate a lease on their behalf. Now, I can tell you what the lease terms that they're offering, but maybe we ought to go through these three. Whatever you think. I also brought to the meeting today to give you an idea of the 10 model homes that they built. So this is the quality that we're looking at on affordable homes. And you can pass them around and keep them, but that's what they're building. Now, in the first month that they're going to be here, number one, they're going to start hiring at the end of this month. Number two, they have to put and improve the side of the building where there's going to be a $6,000 improvement for a double door. So they, when they build the homes inside, they can then move them down the road. We are looking for a consideration from the city council that they be granted a period of 3 months, not totally rent-free, but as an accommodation for the improvements in equipment that they're going to bring in to the industrial building, which also includes the door that I was telling about when they opened up, single door. Plus, they've agreed that they will pay the electrical bill during that first 3 months. And depending on whatever contract you have with a landscaper to mow the grass and keep the building looking in the way it should look. So they're asking for a 3 or we make it 5-year lease. We're looking for the first 90 days. After that, for the next 9 months, they will pay rent of $2,000 a month. After that, it will go up $2,500, $3,000, $4,500, and by the end of your lease period of 5 years, we'll be at $5,000 minimum. Now, this is a consideration that the city council is involved in with a new industry coming in. We're looking in the first month of hiring Franklin County residents or worker bees, if you like. We're going to we can even guarantee 12 to 15 jobs to start with. That's not an issue. We're looking for skilled and unskilled employees for this undertaking. You're going to be amazed when you see the results of these affordable little homes. And here's the floor plans, and you pick out which one you need. And even for an example, the other day I was down to the moorings talking with Lil Max Smith. Hell, he said, could they build four little homes, one bedrooms, and put them on a flotation device so I could rent them out of my marina? I said, yes, they've done that before. Anyways, we're all hot, and I know, but the application is in, and we'd love to negotiate the terms if you want to do a year, but that's the consideration that they're asking to bring their enterprise of little custom homes to Carroll.
All right, thank you, Mr. Question. We're going to let the attorney speak.
Yes, one quick question is to talk, and just because we would do our due diligence to as we had talked about, appreciate you submitting the information, just to do background check and all that. The tenant's name, I know it says William J. Den. It gives a tax ID number that looks like a federal tax ID number of business. I know that at the top it talks about little custom homes in Carabel. Who would be the tenant? Is it, as far as, are you setting up just a new subsidiary or something for Carabel?
Yes, right now they have two enterprises, Little Custom Homes, Arkansas, Little Custom Homes, Mobile. The new entity, and they have the application for Florida, would be Little Custom Homes, Carabel.
Perfect. That's what I needed to know. Thank you.
Sure.
Well, I'm almost wanting to come back to the commission because I know, since we have really had a good opportunity to speak with Mr. Den, I'm not necessarily saying I want to turn it down, by no means. We need to certainly have a firm lease agreement. After the background check is conducted, we need to have a lease agreement. It's going to take Mr. Denton here to sign that and to review that. And I want to have the commissioners have an opportunity to review that lease agreement. And we're going to need a firm term, date of years that you want to lease it, whether it's
August 1st.
The term.
18.
August 1st, I don't know if we're going to be able to make that date. Do you, Mr. Hartman?
I think we need to probably do two things. One, which should go quickly, is some of the background, just looking into the other entities and pulling up what we can just do our job. And then some sharp negotiating on the lease terms, which you've given us a good starting point. This is a better starting point than we had to date by anybody. So that's good. And I forgot at the last meeting we talked about the three of us doing that. So we'll jump on that. And then we may need, if it warrants it, which it sounds like it may, we can tack it on to a special meeting that we're having in July.
Yes, we're going to have a special meeting
end of July.
Perfect. That'll work.
And if we've made progress, because what we talked about last meeting with the mayor, myself, Courtney, pulling something together, we already do have form leases, you fill out form application, and it can move ahead quickly if we can reach terms. And then obviously the terms will be finally approved by the commission. So.
Okay, but they want to be here August 1st.
Okay.
They do want possession of the building because they're shipping a lot of stuff here.
I want to ask,
be careful.
Martin Marine now, the area that Mr.
They can keep it. They can keep it for a couple of years, and you can get the rent from them. That's not an issue. They will not need that whole area. So you have a tenant, and the little custom homes will pay their utility bill, which is one master meter for the whole building.
So, Mr. Parker, that would need to be included in that lease agreement. And I don't know if they'll need a sublease or something, some agreement with Mr. Parker.
Well, Mr. Martin's going to, has a lease with you directly.
Yes, but we want to make sure everybody agrees.
I believe that's not going to be an issue at all.
All right. Then I want to ask Mr. Kip Kane, what do you expect out of this process? Are you expecting something from the city of Caravan?
Certainly. I'd like at least 25-35% of the rent roll that I'm going to bring to Midland. I'm asking for 5% of the rent that they generate. You can pay me annually, semi-annually, and you can pay me for only a 3-year term after that is dropped.
5% of $2,000 is...
Well, 2,000 times 5 is $100. Okay? And that's for bringing the whole industry to employ an additional 12, 15 people, probably more. When you look at the additional people that they're going to need to put these homes on lots.
Mr. Kane, you mentioned earlier you're a licensed Florida
broker. Real estate broker.
Perfect.
And auctioneer.
If you would, I know that. Go ahead and get on into Courtney. I guess they gave me the number. I mean, I know the Florida Real Estate Commission or whatever gives you that number or whatever. Because we need to, obviously, if we're considering paying a commission, we've got to make sure we're paying it to a, as you say, a license.
I will drop off a copy of my license.
Perfect.
Tomorrow
morning. Very good.
Before 10.
9:45.
We are so glad that jobs will be available and houses, and we just discussed briefly that affordable housing is going to be needed desperately here within the next couple of years.
No, immediately.
In the east.
Yesterday.
So, and all of that is good, and we're not going to be, as Mr. Hartman has advised us, that we really shouldn't be concerned with the number of employees that you have, and whether or not you have employees, that's your business. And we're concerned with the rent. And the rent that's made, we'll put that money back into the community, might be able to hire another employee ourselves. So, but we would like to see some affordable housing. We need affordable housing care for teachers, law enforcement officers, DOC, Department of Corrections officers, and medical personnel. We need that.
And brokers. I think I'm going to buy one of them.
Okay. Are you hearing me? That's what we need desperately. And they complain about it at the school board. They don't have enough housing and they cannot get teachers. We need housing like that for families.
Please review the plans. You can pick out any one of these 10, and then you can even customize them. Any other questions?
What do you guys think?
I'm trying to get it done by August the 1st. The advance crew is coming here the last week of this month. They're going to be here. They've already rented them.
And Miss Courtney's going to be off a week now. We got our.
Courtney was just off a week.
You need to come sit on this board with us.
No, you don't want that.
Okay, I'll be in tomorrow, but we can do these rental terms real quick. And even if you want it just for a year, we need to get them here now.
Okay. All right. Now. Mr. Parkman, is there any motion needed here? I'm trying to.
No motion needed. I think from we're what we need to do is get to negotiate quick.
All right.
I can start in 5 minutes.
All right. Please, Mr. Kang, let me handle this here. Just a minute. Do y'all have any discussion, comments, or want to make a motion about something?
I just want to make a comment. It sounds best news I've heard a long time about our building on their airport. And I don't have a problem later than 3 months to get them started. That's what it takes. They're going to be putting money in the building. We want you to read it. You'll come. Fine. We're ready for you. Just get our attorney and our...
We're ready for you, too. Thank you.
You get our attorney and the city manager there to negotiate with you. I'm all on board.
It's been in long enough.
The attorney, the mayor, and also the city administrator have met with the client at least twice.
Good.
Okay?
Okay, and Mr. Melvin, did you have any comment?
No, I think it's well said.
Okay, and I will, I want you all to rest assured that I will make sure that you're informed on all of the, how things are moving along and proceeding. So I want everybody to know, and if you have a comment, please, let me know.
Can I go right?
Yes.
Okay.
All right, so now.
Get out of here. Thank you.
Bye-bye, Mr. Payne.
Appreciate you.
Thank you for waiting through all of this.
Yes, ma'am.
We need to move forward to our public hearing, and we're going to be out here right quick. We need a motion to adjourn our regular meeting and open the public hearing. Okay. And that was by Commissioner Melander. And then a second on that, please.
Second.
A second by Commissioner Mathis. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, so we have a second hearing to amend the 2017-2018 budget to include the CDBG grant funding. We need a motion to amend the 2017-2018 budget to include revenue and expenditure line items in the amount of $650,000 for the CDBG grant. Do you have a motion for that?
I have a motion.
Okay. Melander, Commissioner Melander. We have a second.
Second.
Okay, Commissioner Mathis. All right, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion carries. Now we need a motion for a JPA resolution. Do we have a number for that resolution yet?
It says 03-2030.
That's, it's a resolution, not a proclamation. It's required by.
Still a resolution.
So, but if we don't have a number, you can give us a number.
It's resolution 03. It's on the agenda.
Okay, all right. Okay, that's fine. And we need this resolution to authorize the supplemental JPA for construction of parking apron access to plant hangers and the fuel farm and mitigation of deficiency and the annual inspection for licensing. And now we need to include the survey, construction administration, and other costs related to construction and security events. We need a motion for that JPA resolution. Okay, we have that by Commissioner Walden. Second by Commissioner Melander. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, any opposed? That motion carries. Thank you. Let's have a motion to adjourn the second public hearing. That would be a motion to adjourn the meeting. Okay, we have a motion to adjourn the second public hearing. Second by Commissioner Mathis. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And that motion carries. All right, then that's it. That's it.